This lecture continues the discussion of the scientific method, which was presented as an iterative process as described here. As we observed, the process is not a mechanical workflow, but requires ingenuity. The scientific method combines creativity with the required rigor. A rigorous approach is needed both to turn observations into hypotheses and to deduce predictions based on hypotheses, which lead to further observations with the goal of progressively validating a theory. As we mentioned, two fundamental kinds of reasoning take place in this iterative process: induction and deduction. We will analyze them thoroughly in this lesson. Both induction and deduction can be formalized in mathematical logic. The formalization helps understand them better and sheds more light on the iterative process illustrated by the figure. Deduction is a process of reasoning from one or more statements, premises, to reach logically certain conclusion. It infers the conclusion from the premises. It is also called a syllogism. We arrive at a conclusion based on propositions that are asserted or assumed to be true. In deductive inferences, what is inferred is necessarily true if the premises from which the conclusion is inferred are true. That is, the truth of the premises guarantees the truth of the conclusion. It is a proof. In the context of our iterative process, deductions are applied to make predictions based on current hypotheses. Predicted truths are then used to design experiments to confirm or disprove them. Let us examine a typical deductive inference rule called modus ponens. The rule can be described as follows. From the truth of the statement P implies Q, major premise, and the truth of the statement P, minor premise, we deduce Q. Formally, this can be expressed in mathematical logic as, from the truth of P implies Q, and the truth of P, we can deduce the truth of Q. A classical example of modus ponens is the following. All men are mortal, major premise. Socrates is a man, minor premise, from which we deduce Socrates is mortal, consequence, prediction. Let us see how deduction works in the context of a hypothetical and very simple research example. Suppose that we are interested in understanding the culinary preferences of a population. Suppose that we want to challenge the following hypothesis: Italians like pasta. Modus ponens can be applied to predict additional observations that may result from further experiments. In other terms, we expect that if more experiments will be made with individuals of Italian nationality, the observations would confirm that they like pasta. Formally, this can be expressed as follows. For all XY, knowing that being X Italian implies that X like pasta, and knowing that Y is Italian, we can deduce that Y likes pasta. In designing such experiments, we should do our best to select individuals that are likely to challenge our hypothesis. For example, we should try with individuals from different Italian regions to make sure that the hypothesis equally applies across all of them. We may also try with people of different age, different social groups, etc. In other terms, deduction should not be applied blindly, but should aim at challenging the hypothesis and possibly falsify it. Deductive inference is not symmetric. For example, from P implies Q and P, we can derive Q. But knowing that Q is true, we cannot derive P implies Q and P. Specifically, having observed that Alex likes pasta, we cannot derive the truth of Alex is Italian, even assuming that we know that Italians like pasta. In fact, Alex could be Spanish. nor that Italians like pasta, assuming that we know that Alex is Italian. This brings us to discussing induction. Induction is the logical process that leads to non-necessary conclusions, as opposed to deduction, where conclusions are certain. Being a non-necessary process, it is based on ingenuity and creativity. In the toy example we have been discussing, suppose that we only consider individuals who are Italian. That is, we assume the truth of the minor premise in this formula. And for all of them, we observe that they like pasta. That is the consequence in the formula. A non-necessary kind of induction is generalization. Generalization would lead us to postulate that all Italians like pasta. That is the major premise in the formula. The generalization is supported by a large number of unbiased observations that do not violate the inferred property. Another kind of induction leading to a non-necessary conclusion is explanation. In the example, assuming that all Italians like pasta, the major premise, and observing that an individual likes pasta, the consequence, we would explain the observation by postulating that the individual is Italian. Non-necessary inferences intrinsically need to be validated. Deductive reasoning is used to generate experiments that either confirm or invalidate the hypothesis conjectured through inductive reasoning. If they do not hold, they need to be revised in the form of new hypotheses. To reinforce this statement, the logician and philosopher Bertrand Russell provided the following vivid image in his book, The Problems of Philosophy. Domestic animals expect food when they see the person who usually feeds them. We know that all these rather crude expectations of uniformity are liable to be misleading. The man who has fed the chicken every day throughout its life at last wrings its neck instead, showing that more refined views as to uniformity of nature would have been useful to the chicken. This became popularized as the Bertrand Russell's inductivist turkey, where the chicken becomes a turkey, and the fatal day, when the man wrings its neck, is a day before Christmas or Thanksgiving. Let us now go back to simple case of the research on culinary preferences we have been using as a running example. It is unlikely that research results might be expressed in absolute terms by a theory like all Italians like pasta. Surely there are Italians who don't like pasta and, for example, prefer rice. To account for that, one might summarize the findings through a qualitative theory. Most Italians like pasta. To be more precise, one should try to express the findings in a quantitative way. To account for uncertainty, which is intrinsic in these kinds of problems, the results might be expressed in terms of probabilities. For example, the research might lead to the following conclusion. The probability that Italians like pasta is at least 0.8. This means that repeated experiments performed by the researcher showed that if we take random sets of Italians, at least 8 out of 10 liked pasta. We conclude this lesson by observing that the notion of non-necessary inferences is at the heart of the scientific discovery. It's no surprise that science philosophers actively investigated this notion. I have used the term induction here, but the term abduction is also often used, and the two terms are often associated with different meanings, although there is no general consensus on them. Induction is often used when non-necessary conclusions are only justified based on statistically observed frequencies. Abductions instead are based on some explanatory considerations that justify them. If you're interested in going deeper into these interesting problems, you may refer to the work on the logic of science by philosopher Charles Sanders Peirce.